Thank you very much. It's nice to be here back in South Carolina. I now live up in Asheville, North Carolina. It was fun to come down the mountain today and go from winter to kind of spring, because still the plants are, the trees and shrubs are pretty much leafless up in the higher elevations, but certainly not here. Were any of you out hiking today? What a gorgeous day. Anybody have the joy yesterday? Okay, because the wildflowers are popping. I was on the way down. I decided to make use of the time coming down to lower elevations, and I went to Twin Bridges and hiked that trail. It was really nice. So I'm really happy to have the opportunity to talk to you about our spring wildflowers. And what I'll do is I'm trained as an ecologist, not somebody who just identifies plants. I sort of like to try and understand something about their ecology and natural history. So you'll see, I think, some familiar faces, at least in terms of plants. And I'll try and talk a little bit about their ecology and natural history. And I'll also talk about wildflowers in a broader sense, that is beyond just the herbaceous plants, and talk about a few of the trees and shrubs, particularly some of those that flower very early in spring. So that's the agenda. And in terms of trees, maybe if we could dim the lights a little, that would be great, because I think they'll see the slides a little better. I'm so happy the projector here works so well. The colors seem quite true, and that's always nice. So let's start off with a tree, and the yellow buckeye, which I think many of you are familiar with. It's a good one to start with, because it's, for the most part, our earliest native tree to leaf out in our mountains. The yellow buckeye, and it has these quite distinctive leaves where there are multiple large leaflets arising from a common point. Botanists call a leaf like this palmately compound. And then it has this dense cluster of yellow flowers. And interestingly, the mix of the flowers includes male flowers that produce only pollen, and then other flowers in the inflorescence have both male and female parts. And of course, it's only the ones that have the female parts that mature fruits like this. So one of the reasons in yellow buckeye, where there, one of the reasons why there are fewer fruits than flowers, is because it's only the flowers having female parts that mature fruit. And the pod-like fruits of yellow buckeye are very large, and housed within are 2 to 3 very large seeds, I think among the largest seeds of our native flora. And buckeyes are called buckeye because they have this scar on the seed that botanists think look a bit like a buck's eye, like a deer's eye. And of course, old timers, mountain folks, perhaps in a bygone era, like to carry a buckeye seed in their pocket as a good luck charm, sort of like a rabbit's foot. In the Carolinas, we have three common buckeyes. Red buckeye is common in the coastal plain. Painted buckeye is our Piedmont species of buckeye. And then our mountain species is yellow buckeye. And the yellow buckeye is one that gets to be in, can become a very large tree, an enormous tree, whereas painted buckeye is a shrub, a small tree. So these three buckeyes, and interestingly, the three species are interfertile. If you had them growing in your yard or in a botanical garden, you could take pollen from the red buckeye and introduce it to the stigma of a painted buckeye, and you could get hybrid seeds to form. And this actually occurs in nature because of long-distance flyers, particularly hummingbirds, which visit all three species. And as the hummingbirds are migrating north from Central America, for example, coming up north, not only are they flying north, but they also are flying inland from the coastal plain on up into the mountains. So they can carry pollen from painted buckeye, and we sometimes find hybrid populations of these two species in the Piedmont. Or in the mountains, you can have hybrids between the painted buckeye and the yellow buckeye. There was a graduate student at the University of Georgia who, was using molecular techniques, was able to demonstrate these hybrid populations. So sometimes if you see a buckeye and you're trying to identify and try to key it out and it doesn't seem to fit either species, it's quite likely that it's a hybrid. We sometimes call these hybrid swarms when you have a population that's composed of hybrid individuals. On Glassy Mountain in South Carolina, near the town of Athens, it's a wonderful monadnock. It's a heritage preserve site. Wonderful place to visit, not far from here. And if you go up there, there are definitely hybrids between red buckeye and painted buckeye up there. The flowers are a bright red color. There's introduction of genes from the painted buckeye, the red buckeye into the painted buckeye. Interesting. Carolina silverbell is another tree that flowers very early in the season. It's very distinctive white bell-shaped flowers, nodding white bell-shaped flowers. The flowers don't last long. An individual tree may flower for about 2 weeks and then they're gone. Flowers fall to the ground. Sometimes if you're hiking on a trail and you come around a bend and you look and you see this patch of white and you think, my gosh, is that a patch? Is there snow or what's going on? And then as you get close, you discover that it's just a bunch of petals that have been shed by Carolina silverbell. If everything goes well, the flowers mature into these pod-like fruits that have four wings. The four wings are kind of mysterious to me because these pod-like fruits are fairly large and somewhat heavy, and I'm somewhat skeptical that they're going to be blown much by the wind, but I could be wrong. Usually winged fruits with wings usually are smaller, lighter, and catch the wind and help disperse the seed. The flowers of Carolina silverbell are actively visited by large bees, mainly bumblebees, which function as pollinators. And one can identify Carolina silverbell not only with its distinctive flowers, but the younger stems have yellowish vertical stripes. It's quite a distinctive tree. Okay, pawpaw is another early flowering shrub to small tree. And one of the interesting things about pawpaw are its flowers. They're kind of bizarre. When the flowers first open up, they have this greenish tinge to them, but then they quickly, certain pigments develop, I suspect anthocyanin pigments, and the flower then takes on this maroon to brownish color. And one of the interesting things of pawpaw's reproductive biology is that it's genetically self-incompatible. So in order for a fruit to mature, a plant needs pollen from a different genetic individual. In other words, a plant's self-pollen is not able to fertilize its own ovules or eggs. That can be problematic for pawpaws because pawpaws are a clonal species. I know this firsthand from my yard in Clemson. I planted one tree, and after about 15 years, I had 30 different large stems. I had a population of pawpaws, all of this of the same genetic individual. So when you've got all these stems that are part of the same genetic individual, you're going to have a lot of pollen movement between flowers of the same plant, and that pollen will not be compatible. And the pollinators are flies and beetles, which typically aren't long-distance flyers. So that can be a problem in terms of fruit set and pawpaws. Here are the fruits. If you do come across fruits, they look like this. They tend to vary in flavor. The fruits are often described as tasting like custard. That varies. Some plants produce fruits that are tastier than others. Also, wildlife tend to take them quick. So you have to be kind of quick yourself to get one of these fruits. Don't let them sit too long on the tree because something else will get them. By the way, I took this photograph. I don't see ripe fruits in the wild too often. So I got this photograph in Washington, D.C., just outside the Natural History Museum at the Smithsonian. So not too many wildlife species there, I guess. And one of the interesting things about pawpaws is its interaction with the zebra swallowtail butterfly. You know, the leaves of pawpaws have a very strong odor. If you break a leaf or crumple a leaf and smell it, Patrick McMillan has described it as smelling like diesel fuel. And that's because there's some nasty chemicals in those leaves. And most things avoid feeding on pawpaws. I bet you deer don't feed on pawpaws. I could be wrong because of these chemicals. So few things feed on them. And most butterflies, their caterpillars, avoid feeding on pawpaws. But there is a butterfly, the zebra swallowtail, who has adapted evolutionarily over many years, presumably, to be able to cope with the chemicals of pawpaws, and it's become a specialist on pawpaws, where the female adult zebra swallowtails fly around looking, or smelling perhaps, the odor of pawpaws, and then laying their eggs specifically on pawpaws. So they're host-specific in terms of their larval or caterpillar food plant. They do taste bad, so it's much like monarch butterflies, yeah. So the caterpillars, both the caterpillars and the adults, are protected by feeding on the plant. So this is sort of a double whammy against the plant. Not only has the animal circumvented the plant defense, but the animal is utilizing the plant defense for its own defense. So it's quite interesting. There are a number of butterflies that do that, besides the monarchs and zebra swallowtails. Let's talk a little bit about spice bush, one of our very earliest shrubs. Has anybody seen spice bush in bloom this spring? Oh, quite a few of you. Okay. Looks like this, kind of dense clusters of tiny yellow flowers, which form these kind of pom-pom-like clusters on the stem. They're separate male and female plants in spice bush. It's described as being dioecious. So obviously, the female plants are depending on something to get the pollen to them. It's not a wind-pollinated species. It has sticky pollen, and as such, the pollen isn't blown around by the wind. And so it depends on small bees and perhaps flies to function as pollinators. And if everything goes well on a female plant, you get red fruits like this by late summer or fall. And the fruits of spice bush are rich in lipids. They're fatty fruits. They're not sweet fruits. It's not a fruit that you and I would find very tasty. But because of the high caloric content of lipids relative to sugars, these have a much higher energy value. So migrating birds in the fall, this is a preferred food of the lipid-rich fruits like spice bush and black gum and flowering dogwood and sassafras are sought after by birds because of their higher energy content. If you're going to migrate a long distance and you have a small stomach, you want to fill that stomach with high energy fruits, the lipid-rich fruits. So birds disperse birds consume the pulp of spice bush, and in the process then disperse the seeds in their dropping. So we have a mutualism here. The plant is providing a food, and the animal in turn is dispersing the seed of the plant. It's called spice bush for a couple of reasons. The leaves are quite fragrant, but also the fruits are very fragrant. They have kind of a spicy fragrance to them. And another interesting animal connection in spice bush are the caterpillars. This is a host plant, one of two host plants for the spice bush swallowtail butterfly. In the mountains, the spice bush, female spice bush butterflies lay their eggs only on spice bush and, anybody know the other plant? Sassafras. Sassafras is in the same family as spice bush. And the butterflies will lay their eggs on either one. And what a spectacular caterpillar this is. Almost looks like a small snake. Perhaps that's a defense mechanism for birds. Birds may be startled. Birds are afraid of snakes typically, and they may be startled when this see this caterpillar and it kind of rears up and moves its head a little bit. These are the eyes. The mouth would be there. Okay, and of course rhododendrons. We have lots of native rhododendrons in our woods and the mountains and Piedmont. We've got, in the Carolinas as a whole, we have three or four, depending on the taxonomy that you follow, evergreen species of rhododendron that are native. And then we have more than a dozen deciduous species of rhododendron. The deciduous species of rhododendron are typically called azaleas. So I wanted to just illustrate one of each. A very early flowering one is the pinkster flower. and rhododendron periclymenoides, and one of our evergreen species is one that occurs in the gorge, mainly in the escarpment area, so not far from here. A very common rhododendron would be gorge rhododendron, or sometimes called punctatum. It's the smallest of the three or four evergreen rhododendrons. This one has the smallest leaves. Flowers range in color from white to pink. And a vine. Let's talk about a vine or two. And how about this one, the coral honeysuckle? This is our native honeysuckle, Onycera sempervivens. We have several natives, but this is the most striking one for sure, with its bright red colored flowers, which have these narrow flower tubes, a very narrow tubular corolla or flower, and only long-tongued critters then can get at the nectar, and those long-tongued critters would be butterflies and hummingbirds, which are able to get the nectar from the flowers and in the process function as pollinators. This is a wonderful plant to have in your garden, wonderful plant to see in the wild as well. It's not a weedy thing. It's not thug-like. It's not like Japanese honeysuckle at all. It tends not to spread. You see it kind of sporadically. It's not aggressive. It's not going to outcompete other species. And it's a wonderful plant because it flowers in the spring and then flowers sporadically in the summer and the fall, depending on conditions. And the flowers develop into these fleshy red fruits, which are dispersed by birds. Okay, so now let's talk about the more traditional wildflowers, the herbaceous plants. And if you're a hiker this time of year, maybe a little bit earlier down here in the Piedmont, you're familiar with this kind of scene whereby the forest floor is green and has clearly begun to initiate growth. It's actively growing, whereas the trees above are still dormant. What's going on there? Why are the herbaceous plants, the ground cover, how has it been able to green up and begin growing, whereas the buds on the trees are still dormant? What's driving that? These are flocks. This is blue flocks. This is in Great Smoky Mountain National Park.
I've never seen bluebells here. I don't understand why.
Virginia bluebells?
Yeah.
Go to Great Smoky Mountain National Park. If you go to this site, there are Virginia bluebells. It's a nice area. This is the White Oak Sink area near Townsend in Great Smoky Mountain National Park. You can see both blue flocks and dense carpets and Virginia bluebells, too. Well, so what's driving this? Why are the herbaceous plants emerging, growing, flowering, and producing fruits while the trees above are still dormant?
I think it's the earth temperature.
You've got it. The temperature, that as we're transitioning from winter into spring, or maybe even before spring, sun's getting higher in the sky, and the day length is increasing. And as the sun is getting higher in the sky, sun's rays are hitting the Earth's surface, the ground, and that's warming up to a greater extent than the air above. So the temperature of the buds of these plants that are right at ground level, or in some cases just below the ground, is higher than the temperature surrounding the buds on the woody plants, the trees and shrubs. And that's ecologically very, very important, because in another 4, 5, 6 weeks, these trees are all going to leaf out and you'll have a very dense, shady canopy with not much light reaching the forest floor. So the advantage in terms of earlier growth of these herbaceous plants, it really is a time of year when they do a very significant amount of their vegetative growth, and many of them flower. And some of them, even as the trees leaf out and it becomes shaded, some of these herbaceous perennials actually die back, where their growing season ends, not because of drought or frost, but rather shade. So that's an interesting thing both to see and ecologically. So let's talk about these plants that are called spring ephemerals. And I'm talking about what are true spring ephemerals, and true spring ephemerals, a technical term for species that emerge very early, often late winter or very early in spring. These are plants that grow very rapidly over a short growing season, between the temperatures of the soil warming up and before it becomes really dark and shady in the forest understory. It may be a growing season of about a month to as long as 2 months. And in terms of the spring ephemerals, these are really canopy avoiders. The true spring ephemerals are dying back and going dormant once the canopy leaves out. So the plants are still alive, but they're just dormant and underground, and you don't see them. So it's quite remarkable. Some of these plants have a growing season as short as about 4 weeks, as long as about 8 weeks. Yet they're herbaceous perennials. They're perennial plants. They live for multiple years, in some cases decades, but have a very short growing season. So I want to talk about five or six of these spring ephemerals, and I'll talk about each of the species that are listed here, and I think you're probably familiar with some of them. And so let's start off with Carolina Spring Beauty. So these spring ephemerals are plants you're going to see early in the growing season, but not later. Okay, you won't see them in June or July or August. You'll see them in February, maybe March, maybe April. Of course, elevation plays a role. If you're at 5,000 feet, you know, spring, late winter, spring may not come until May. So some of them pop out earlier, but then die back as it gets shady. So Carolina Spring Beauty is a spring ephemeral. It dies back as the shade, with the onset of shade. Beautiful plant. They're two different species of spring beauty. One has these wider leaves. There's also Virginia spring beauty, which has a pair of very narrow leaves. Notice the pink stripes here. There's actually a biological significance to those pink lines radiating to the center of the flower. These are what are called nectar guides, the helping guide a potential pollinator, in this case, small bees typically, to the center of the flower where the pollen or nectar is located. And that benefits the bee because it can forage more efficiently, feed on nectar or pollen more rapidly, and may benefit the plant because it may guide the insect into the flower in such a way that it's more likely to brush against the anthers and maybe brush some pollen against a stigma, resulting in pollination. Carolina Spring Beauty, if you're hiking on a cloudy day, you're not going to see this plant. At least you're not going to see the open flowers. The flowers only open up on sunny days. They also close at night. They can be open, and then clouds obscure the sun. The flowers will close. If the sun opens up again, and the flowers will open up. Trout lily. Many of us love trout lilies. Very showy plants, quite common. It too is a spring ephemeral. You're going to see it early in the growing season, but not later. It goes dormant once it becomes shady. And like spring beauty, trout lily flowers close up at night. And so if you're an early morning hiker, the flowers of trout lily are going to look like this. And then by mid-morning or so, depending on temperature and light, the petals reflex back and becomes a more typical star-shaped flower. It's called trout lily because botanists tend to be quite imaginative. Look at the model leaves. The speckled leaves looks a little bit like a rainbow trout. Okay, and trout lilies are pollinated by bumblebees, queen bumblebees, that emerge very early in the season. But you know, not every day is favorable for bumblebee or other pollinators to fly. If you're these plants that are flowering very early in the season, late winter, early spring, are often exposed to cloudy, rainy, windy, foggy days when pollinators aren't active. And this is a plant that requires pollinators. It needs pollen to be planted for these fruits to mature. So one of the things that trout lily has going for it, well, there are two things. One is that the individual flowers are very rich in nectar. So queen bumblebees tend to hone in on this plant because it's a very good nectar source when they're flying. Secondly, the individual flowers of trout lily can last up to about 10 days, which increases the likelihood that the flower, an individual flower, will be open on one or more days when queen bees are flying. The seeds of trout lily are dispersed by ants, and this is a fruit that's been, something has eaten, and it could well be ants that have cut into the fruit to get the seeds. And we'll talk very shortly, and a number of our woodland plants, in addition to trout lily, have ant-dispersed seeds. Okay, Dutchman's breeches is a striking plant. Has this very delicate, lacy foliage, and then coming up is the flower stalk with these kind of bizarre-looking flowers that hang down. Here's the front of the flower here. The back of the flower kind of looks like breeches hanging on a clothesline. And the pant legs, so to speak, what they really are, those are nectar spurs. So they're nectaries here on this part of the flower that produce nectar, and long-tongued bees, such as bumblebees, then have long enough mouth parts to get at that nectar up in these nectar spurs. And it's another, by the way, it's another ant plant whose seeds are dispersed by ants. So I'm using this symbol here to indicate those plants that have ant-dispersed seeds. So fringed phasalia. Are you familiar with fringed phasalia? Anybody seen this plant in the wild? Okay, some of you have. It's a plant, it's quite unusual in that this is not a perennial. This is an annual plant. This is a winter annual, meaning that its seeds germinate in the fall and it forms a vegetative rosette and grows in the fall, is probably dormant through most of winter. And then in the spring, as temperatures warm up, those rosettes very actively grow, and it flowers, fruits, and then dies back with shade. So it's an ephemeral too, but it's one that persists from year to year via dormant seed rather than as an underground part, such as a rhizome or corm or some other underground structure. And fringed phasalia can really form dense carpets. I took this photo about a year ago in Great Smoky Mountain National Park in the Greenbrier area. And this area, this slope was just covered by fringed phasalia. It was really beautiful. And here, the first tree beginning to leaf out here is the yellow buckeye. Okay, now let's talk about other wildflowers whose leaves then persist underneath a shady canopy. So all of the rest of our wildflowers then are not spring ephemerals. They may flower early in the season, and hepaticas certainly flower very early, but then its leaves persist under a shady canopy. Okay, and it's called the cute-lobed hepatica because this is one leaf here, and it has three lobes, and each lobe has a sharp point. There's a second species of hepatica where the lobes have a round, they're rounded at the tip, and it's called round-lobed hepatica. Okay, and it used to be in the genus hepatica, but recently it's been changed to the genus anemone. So it's now anemone acuta loba, but hepatica is still in the common name. And it too has ant-dispersed seeds. And in hepaticas and a couple of other wildflowers that we'll talk about shortly, the leaves, it's a perennial, but its leaves persist for 1 year. So here are some new leaves coming out in the spring. And then those leaves coming out in the spring last about a year. So the following year, when the plant emerges and begins actively growing, the old leaves die back and a new flush of leaves is produced from an underground rhizome. And an underground rhizome is a stem-like structure that has buds and is underground. The flowers of hepaticas are often in clusters like this, they can be white, they can be pink, they can even be kind of a bluish color. How about foam flower? In the genus Tiarella, it's another early flowering wildflower. It has maple-like leaves and then a dense cluster of white petals with orange stamens. This is kind of unusual. Most pollen is yellow. In the case of foam flower, the pollen is orange. So, you know, what are the colors of Clemson? Orange and white. So we've got orange and white here representing the flower. So I would tell my students at Clemson, you should plant this in your yard if you're a real Clemson fan. And there are actually two varieties of foam flower. One variety has stolons, which are an above-ground stem. So if you grow one plant, it will form a mat. As the stems grow out horizontally, it will send up additional fruit. So this could, well, this is perhaps the variety that is clonal, forming these stems and multiple shoots within a single genetic individual. And then the other variety doesn't have stolons, but it tends to produce more flowers and more seed. So it's allocating its resources more towards reproduction by seed than vegetative reproduction. So that's kind of interesting. Two different strategies in terms of where the resources are primarily being allocated. And of course, we've got to talk about bloodroot as a favorite wildflower. This to me is a must-see plant each spring. What a beautiful flower in bloodroot. And of course, it's called bloodroot because it has a pigment right at the base of the stem here. If you were to scrape the base of the stem a little bit, or the root, the underground root, which is really, it's not a root really, it's a rhizome, it's an underground stem. If you scrape it, you get this blood orange to red color, okay, which presumably has some chemicals in it which may deter animals from feeding on the tissue. It probably has a chemical deterrent to it. But let's talk a little bit about this plant. It does have a rhizome. It's a short rhizome, 6 to 8 inches. And then in late winter, early spring, the buds on that rhizome, as the soil warms up, the buds break, much as like as a bud would burst open above ground, but this is happening underground. And each bud then produces a leaf and a flowering stem, with the flowering stem having just a single flower. So this is a single plant here, single rhizome with multiple leaves, each with a flower. And the flowers of bloodroot are nectarless, so there's no nectar to attract pollinators. So the pollinator attractant of this plant, it's only the pollen. And look at those, the striking yellow anthers, the anthers being the structure that holds the pollen. Lots of pollen is being produced. That pollen has a dual function. Pollen functions as an attractant to pollinators, but also the pollen carries the male gamete. So when the pollen grain is deposited on the stigma of the flower, the pollen tube carries the male gamete down to the egg cell. So it would be to the plant's disadvantage if all the pollen was taken by bees and small bees and flies, and if none was reaching the stigmas, that would be a problem for the plant. Let me tell you a little bit about quickly how this plant copes with the potential paucity of pollinators during cold, wet, or windy conditions. When the flowers open up, anthers and the stigma are spatially separated so that self-pollination cannot occur. But after about 3 days, if cross-pollination has not occurred, then the anthers will curl inward and brush against the stigmas. So oftentimes in bloodroot, you get a mix of seeds produced, some via cross-pollination and some via self-pollination. And generally, the seeds derived from cross-pollination are more vigorous than those derived from self-pollination. But it's better to have a seed produced by self-pollination than no seed at all. Now, when the leaves emerge, they're small and they have a vertical orientation. But as the leaves age and as the canopy becomes more shaded, the leaves do two things. They change their orientation from vertical to horizontal, and the leaves get progressively larger during the growing season. So initially, these leaves may be 2 inches across, but by midsummer, some bloodroot leaves can be the size of a small plate, maybe 6, 7, even 8 inches across. And with their horizontal orientation, they're more efficient at capturing light, both because they're perpendicular to the sun's rays when the sun is most bright, and they have a larger surface area with larger size. So there are lots of interesting things going on with bloodroot, including their seeds are ant dispersed. So let's talk a little bit about our woodland wildflowers whose seeds are dispersed by ants. They kind of have a weird thing attached to the seed. Look at these worm-like structures, these white worm-like structures attached to these bloodroot seeds. Those are part of the seed, and they're called, the technical term is an elaiosome. Let's just use the term food body, which describes this as well. These are food bodies attached to the seed, and they're rich in lipids. And as the, and this is the fruit of a bloodroot here, and as the seeds mature, these lipids develop on these food bodies, and they emit a fragrance that ants can detect. So ants can detect when they're ripe seeds by their ability to smell these lipid-rich food bodies. And what the ants do is they collect the seeds and they bring them back to their nest. I think I've got a picture here. Here's a different species with the food body. It looks a little different on this species. So the ants will collect the seeds and they bring them back to their nest. Carry the seeds down into the nest. These are often ground nesting ants. Many of our forest ants are nest in the ground. And then in the nest, within the nest, they remove the body, and what do they do with it? Do the adult ants eat it? No, they feed their larvae. The food bodies are utilized by, are consumed by the ant larvae. So they remove the, they don't remove the food body until they get the seed into the nest. And they feed it to the ant larvae. And then ants are real fastidious. They're concerned about bacteria and fungal growth in their nest. So foreign objects like seeds, that with once the food body's been removed, are not good. So they carry those the seeds back up, and they dump them usually near somewhere near the entrance to their nest, where they subsequently can germinate and grow. So the ants aren't harming the seeds. In fact, they're benefiting the plant by they're benefiting the plant by dispersing the seeds. And then secondly, ripe seeds are subject to being consumed by rodents, such as mice. A lot of seeds can be eaten by mice to the plant. So these ants tend to very quickly, because they can smell the lipids in the food bodies, they tend to remove the seeds quickly from the plant and disperse them, reducing the likelihood of them being eaten by rodents. So the seeds are being dispersed away from the parent plant, spreading the plant, so to speak, and reducing the risk of the seeds being consumed. And so the plant is benefiting in those two ways, and in turn the ant is benefiting by acquiring a larval source. So we have a mutualism. And just to give you an idea of some of our woodland wildflowers whose seeds are dispersed by ants, and notice, you'll see here, these are all woodland wildflowers that grow on the ground. We don't have any ant-dispersed plants that are trees and shrubs where the ants would have to climb way up into a tree or a shrub. So these are plants that have fruits readily available to ants. So bloodroot and our trilliums are ant dispersed. Our violets, we have about 18 different species of native violets, most of which are ant dispersed. Spring beauty has ant dispersed seeds, trout lily, and wild ginger are just some of the many spring wildflowers whose seeds are dispersed by ants. And most of the ant-dispersed plants are ones that flower in the spring and mature their fruits fairly quickly. Later in the season, the ants have access to other kinds of food to feed their larvae. So ants feed their larvae other things other than just the food bodies, and they tend to go for other things later in the season. Let's talk a little bit about wild ginger, one of our ant-dispersed plants here. It's a plant that has each stem, if you will, has a pair of leaves. And then at the base of the stem is this flower here that's really quite beautiful. But oftentimes it goes unseen by humans because it tends to be covered or obscured by the leaves. And wild ginger is a plant that also spreads vegetatively. It has a stolon. So here's an example here. This is an above-ground stem. And from this above-ground stem, there are multiple leaf pairs arising. So when you see a dense clump of wild ginger like this, that it's a pretty good chance that that could be just a single genetic individual, a single individual that's spread vegetatively. And notice this wild ginger has these kind of heart-shaped leaves. Oh, they may be 3-4 inches across. And this is a deciduous species. It drops its leaves senesce in the fall. Okay? In contrast, we have another plant that's sometimes called wild ginger, or it's also called little brown jugs. This is in a different genus, though. The wild ginger that's deciduous is in the genus, let's go back one more. The wild ginger that's deciduous is in the genus Acerum, whereas the wild gingers that are evergreen, their leaves persist year-round, are in the genus Hexastylus. And it's sometimes called little brown jugs because at the base of the leaf, you have these little jug-like flowers. And it too, like the Acerum, species of Hexastylus have ant-dispersed seeds. Let's talk about trilliums. Anybody know somebody who doesn't like trilliums? Everybody likes trilliums. Okay, and we've got, this is the mecca, this is the world's mecca for trilliums. Worldwide, there are about 50 species of trillium. Where do you find them? Trilliums are native to eastern and western North America, so you can find them on the eastern United States and the western United States. And then where else can you find native trilliums? Anybody know? Anybody? In Japan and Asia. They're native to Asia too. But there are fewer species in Asia than here. We have about 30 of the 50 species of trilliums that are found in the southeastern United States. The southern Appalachians have a particularly high concentration of trilliums, and there isn't time to talk about them all. But let's start with this one, which is this is our most common Piedmont species of trillium, Catesby's trillium, named for the early botanist in eastern North America named Mark Catesby. And this is one of those trilliums where the flowers are initially white and they change to a pinkish color with age or perhaps after pollination. And this is a trillium that, like bloodroot, is nectarless. And the reward to attract pollinators is the pollen. So some trillium species produce nectar, others don't. This happens to be one that doesn't produce any nectar. It's the pollen that's the attractant to potential pollinators. And how about this one, wake robin, or sometimes called stinking willy, because the flowers have kind of an odor that the human nose finds unpleasant, but the carrion flies and carrion beetles who like this fetid odor and are attracted to it and function as pollinators. Carrion flies and beetles are the pollinators. And Trillium erectum is a species that varies in flower color from this maroon color to white, in some cases a yellowish green color. And large flowered trillium is a trillium that you don't find typically a single plant. When you see large flowered trillium, you typically find it in clumps, can form dense mats. This, for example, this slope here, this wasn't taken in Great Smoky Mountain National Park just a week ago in the Greenbrier area of Great Smoky Mountain National Park. Came along the trail, and this is massive. A group of large flower trillium. And it's one whose flowers initially are white, but change to pink color as they age. And this is a good nectar source. The large flower trillium, unlike Catesby's trillium, is a good nectar producing plant. And of course, pollen also would reward too. And the pollinators of large flower trillium include small bees like this, which may forage on nectar and pollen as well. And then we have the largest of our trilliums. It's not Trillium grandiflorum. It's actually this one, Trillium vasei. And usually the flowers are maroonish in color like this, but occasionally you'll come across white-flowered plants like this. And this is usually the last trillium to flower. It flowers a little bit later than the others, and it has kind of a pleasant fragrance, kind of a sweet sour kind of fragrance that I at least kind of find kind of nice. Here, by the way, are the stigmas of the flower. This is the part of the flower where the pollen must reach for pollination to occur. So in this flower like you have here, you have the anthers spatially separated from the stigma. So something is necessary, an animal in this case is needed, to move the pollen from the anthers to the stigmas. Thinking of flowers, a flower fragrance that's unpleasant to the human nose, black cohosh is one that fits that label. If you get your nose up close to black cohosh, you may regret it. Because it is an unpleasant odor to us, but not to carrion flies or carrion beetles, which function as pollinators of this plant. And just a practical application of this talk, and I think some of you have heard me say this before, or you perhaps have heard it elsewhere, but if you're out in the woods and the mosquitoes are bad, an emergency insect repellent, if you happen to have left your repellent at home, you can take the flowers, take a few flowers, collect a few flowers here, black cohosh, and rub them on your skin. You may get your buddies to rub them on their skin too, otherwise you may be a little bit of an outcast because they won't want to smell you. But it does repel the bugs. Notice the other common name for black cohosh, bugbane, the bane of bugs. Most bugs don't avoid this plant. They don't like the odor that it has. However, the one potential downside is that you may, if you rub it on your skin, you'll definitely will keep the mosquitoes at bay, but you may attract a few carrion flies and carrion beetles. But that's not a problem. They'll quickly realize you're not dead meat and will fly off somewhere else and won't bother you. But that's black cohosh. And of course, the use of black cohosh is much better known. It's used as a medicinal plant for what purpose? Anybody know? Black cohosh used as a medicinal plant. For what? Right. For hot flashes. It's used if you have hot flashes. It's you can buy it in pill form. And it helps quite a bit. Okay, let's talk about Solomon's seal. And actually, we have two species of Solomon's seal shown here. And this was taken in nature. One species of Solomon's seal was growing directly above the other. So let's first talk about this Solomon's seal. And this is Solomon's seal that has this Latin name, Polygonatum biflorum. It's sometimes called true Solomon's seal. It has flowers that hang down from the stem, kind of yellowish-green flowers that hang down from the stem that are pollinated by bumblebees. Bumblebees very actively. I was watching today at Twin Bridges and also Pearson's Falls, where I where I went to as well, the bumblebees working the Solomon seal flowers, get nectar from them and perhaps pollen as well. The flowers later mature these bluish black fruits in late summer, fall, which are eaten by birds, which disperse the seeds. And then if you've got, you sometimes see in nature, or perhaps in your backyard, deer will browse these plants. They'll feed on the stems way down to here and markedly reduce flower and seed production. But the plants have an underground stem or rhizome, so they typically survive. But they've lost some of their resources for that year in the way of food produced by photosynthesis. So it does have an on the plant. The other Solomon seal is this one here. Notice the flowers are clustered at the tip, almost have a plume-like look to them. So it's called plume Solomon seal. It's also known as Solomon seal, and I used to use that term. And in my first book, I used the term false Solomon seal. And then I was leading a hike, and a woman hike said, "What's false about that plant? Why do you call it false? That plant's not false. It's exhibiting its likeness. You know, why do you call a plant false?" And I think people have become a little bit aware that maybe calling a plant false is maybe not the best descriptor for a plant. So in my second book, I use the term plume Solomon seal, as many people do today. But you may know this plant as either name. It's in a different genus than the other Solomon seal. It's the genus Myanthemum. And this is a plant that depends on pollinators for fruit production. And its fruits are edible. The fruits look like this, whereas the other Solomon seal, they're bluish black. These are kind of a reddish color. And they mature in the summer or early fall. They're edible, but they're mildly cathartic. And so maybe I'm adding a word to your vocabulary here. Just cathartic, what does that mean? Can you guess? Some fruits, if you eat a lot of fruits, might cause a bowel movement. And I mention that in part because biologically that's significant, because if you're a plant and you have fleshy fruits and you want to attract animals to disperse your seeds, you don't want those seeds persisting in the animal's gut too long, because the acids in the gut digesting the pulp may actually digest and kill the seeds. So really there are quite a few plants that have cathartic fruits as a way to get the seeds through the animal's gut more quickly. So you can eat these fruits, just don't eat too many of them, otherwise you may have to rush to a restroom. How about mayapple? I have to talk a little bit about mayapple. One of the things I like about mayapple is this time of year when it's just emerging. And now mayapple has an underground stem, a rhizome, whereas bloodroot, the rhizome is maybe 6 to 8 inches long on a good sized plant. The rhizome of mayapple can be really long, like a short hose, maybe 30 feet long. And then on this underground stem, the rhizome are, again, multiple buds. And each bud then is giving rise to a vertical stem in the spring. And when that stem is pushing its way up through the soil here, the leaf is wrapped around the stem tip as tight as it can be, wrapped very tightly around the stem tip. And it's not green. It's probably a whitish or grayish color. And then once the stem tip pops up above the soil, the leaf begins to unfold, sort of like an umbrella opening up. And if that leaf is exposed to light, very quickly the chlorophyll molecules are synthesized, and the leaf becomes this green color, which of course enables it, with that chlorophyll, to photosynthesize and begin to produce sugars. So in a clump of mayapple, you often have as leaves emerging at various stages. So I kind of sometimes, when I see a field of these mayapples that are looking like this, I think of them as almost like mini spaceships landing on the soil. Interesting thing, a curious thing about mayapple is that it is a flowering plant, but it's only the stems that have paired leaves that produce a flower. So next time you look at a patch of mayapple, you'll see that most of the stems have just a single leaf and don't have a flower. A minority of the stems have two leaves, and if you look carefully, maybe you have to spread the leaves a little bit, you'll see the flower between the leaves, which is quite a large flower. And here's a patch of mayapple. This was taken at Station Cove Falls near Walhalla, South Carolina. It's a wonderful place to go in the spring, this time of year, well, from mid-March to about mid-April, to see the spring wildflowers. It's a very rich area. And there's some big patches of mayapple like this. And it's possible, I don't know for certain, but it's possible that a patch like this could be a single genetic individual with an unusually large rhizome that kind of, winding, spread out. Jewelweeds are an interesting plant. We've got two species, orange jewelweed and yellow jewelweed. And jewelweeds are unusual in that they're annual plants. They're like the fringe phacelia. It's an annual. But whereas the fringe phacelia is a winter annual, jewelweeds are a summer annual, meaning that the seeds germinate in spring, and then the plants are growing in the spring through summer. They flower, fruit, and then die and persist as dormant seeds for the next year. But one of the remarkable things about our jewelweeds is how big they get in just a single season's growth, from spring through into summer and into early fall. They can get 6 feet tall and nearly as wide. But one of the things about jewelweeds, a way that they're conserving energy, is the stems are hollow. The stems of jewelweed are hollow. And so they're not expending as much resources on stem tissue as they otherwise might. But still, they are remarkably large. I mean, consider many of our herbaceous perennial plants are much smaller, and they live decades. So this is a plant that is photosynthesizing and producing a lot of food within a single year. And by being so large, they can produce an enormous number of flowers, fruits, and seeds. And our orange jewelweed attracts bumblebees, both bumblebees, which are getting the nectar here at the base of the flower, and also hummingbirds are attracted to orange jewelweed. Both the bumblebees and hummingbirds are getting nectar from the flowers, and in the case of the bees, they can get pollen too. And this bumblebee here, this is a female bumblebee, she's been collecting pollen and collecting it on her back leg here, her pollen basket. She uses that pollen as to feed her larvae. The sole food source for bee larvae is pollen, often with a little bit of nectar. There's a very tight relationship, interaction, a codependency in many cases between bees and flowers. Bees are getting nectar as an energy source, getting pollen as a source to feed their young, and in turn, more plants are pollinated by bees than any other kind of pollinator. And let me just pose this. How many native bee species do you think we have in North America? Can you think of one? What's a native? Can you think of one native bee species? Is the honeybee a native bee species? It's native to Europe. You know. Mason bees, okay, one. Leafcutter bees, carpenter bees, bumblebees. That's about as far as I can, but there are about 4,000 native bees in North America, 4,000, and worldwide there's about 20,000 different species of bees, and almost all those bee species depend on plants for their larval food. That is pollen mixed with a little bit of nectar, and adult bees' nectar is an essential energy source for the adult bees. Okay, so Jewelweeds are called jewelweeds, but they're also called touch-me-nots, and I think many of you have experienced this. They're called touch-me-nots because if you touch a mature fruit like this, it will burst open. This is a plant that goes ballistic in the sense of flinging its seeds away from the parent plant and thereby spreading the plant. So something, do this with your kids, and kids can be any age. Touch a mature fruit like this, and you'll see how the fruits burst open. Oconee bells, what a plant. Many of you, it's a plant that is much loved by many people, particularly in South Carolina. Its main distribution is in South Carolina. It gets into North Carolina a little bit, and just barely into Georgia, I think just one population. But it's a plant of the escarpment, nowhere else. It only occurs in the escarpment in those three states. Typically, it has very kind of a specialized habitat in nature, and these beautiful flowers that you see here. Another nectarless flower, pollen is functioning as the food reward to attract potential pollinators. It's a plant that you often see mats like this. You typically don't see a single plant, and that's because it spreads vegetatively. Let's finish up by talking about three unusual plants. And these are the three here. We've got, what is this one here? What is it? Some people might call it that. That's not one of its more frequently used common names. Squab root, or bearcorn, sometimes called cancer root, I think. This one? I was seeing a lot of this today. And how about this one?
Pink lady slipper.
Okay, let's talk about these three. These are bizarre plants, or at least unusual plants. I'd like to name bearcorn for this plant because bears absolutely love this plant. And it also looks like corn, right? This is a plant popping up from the soil in the early spring. I saw a couple of little plants of it today just starting to pop up. This is a parasitic flowering plant, so it's unusual in that sense. There's no green in it. There's no chlorophyll. It's not producing its own food. To survive, to grow, to reproduce, it needs to tap in and get resources from another plant. It's a root parasite, and it typically parasitizes the roots of oaks, but it can tap into the roots of some other trees as well. And what we're looking at here is the stem tissue. Flowers. These are numerous flowers here on the outer portion of the stem, which produce nectar and are pollinated by bees. But bears very actively feed on this plant throughout the growing season, but perhaps even most frequently early on in the spring after they've emerged from a long hibernation or pseudo-hibernation. And imagine yourself as a bear. It spent the winter in a cave or in the hollow of a tree, and you then start to become active and so on. And some of these bears apparently have digestive problems when they first emerge because this plant has a natural laxative in high concentration. Do not eat bear corn. You will regret it. You can eat those cathartic fruits, you know, like on the plume solvency. Please, don't eat this. But bear eat it, and that clears their digestive system, and they will continue to feed on it throughout the growing season, maybe to deal with digestive issues later in the summer. I was hiking in Great Smoky Mountain National Park on a very popular trail, the Rainbow Falls trail. Outside of Gatlinburg, and it was in the evening, and I watched a bear for 45 minutes go from clump to clump to clump of bear corn and feed on the stems and then paw the soil and feed on the connecting tissue of bear corn that was connecting on to the root of the host plant. And it knew I was there. It looked at me a couple times. I was kind of trying to hide behind a tree. It smelled me. It knew I was here, but it didn't pay any attention to me. It was focused on this. plant. And because it will feed on the plants even when later in the season when they're in fruit and look like this, and when bearcorn is in fruit, you've got those flowers develop into what look like small grapes that are just chock full of tiny seeds. So when the bears feed on the fruiting plants, they take in the seeds, and those tiny seeds pass readily through the bear's gut, and the bear then is spreading coneflower on the forest floor. So the bear is getting some food value, some nutritional value, but also this natural laxative, which it seems to crave. So when you're hiking in the woods, some of these things that we're talking about, maybe this is a pretty good story here with a biological basis, share this with your friends. They may seem think you're crazy like me, but knowing these things about these plants, I think they're interesting things, but it also may help you remember the plant. Yeah, bearcorn, that's bearcorn, because bear feed on it, and this is why they feed on it, so spread the word. Okay, just a couple of other parasitic plants. Indian pipe, no chlorophyll here, no green, it's a parasite. Pine sap, another parasitic plant. And jack-in-the-pulpit is a plant that is unusual. Well, the shape of this, what looks like a flower here is really an inflorescence. Because if you look inside here, if you spread this leaf-like structure open, and you look at the base here, you have multiple flowers. These are the flowers down here. The stigma and this is the ovary. Cluster of flowers, there's one, but they're at the base here. It's called jack-in-the-pulpit because this kind of looks like an old-fashioned pulpit. And here's Jack, the minister, standing in the pulpit. And then the flowers are at the feet. Yeah. But really, this plant should be called Jack or Jill in the pulpit because an inflorescence can consist of either all male flowers or all female flowers. In this case, they're all female flowers. So this really maybe we should call this Jill in the pulpit here. These are all female flowers. And one of the interesting things about Jack in the pulpit, and this is a herbaceous perennial that can live decades, 20, 30 years, perhaps longer. And one of the interesting things about this plant is that a population then consists of either male or female plants, and it's only the plants that are large that are female. Smaller plants of jack-in-the-pulpit, well, some plants are vegetative and don't even produce that a cluster of flowers. Other plants are small and produce a cluster of flowers, but they typically are male. In contrast, it's only the large plants, like this one here, and here's the inflorescence here. Look, notice the large leaves. This plant maybe is about 16 inches tall with robust leaves, and presumably it has an underground structure. I think it's a bulb-like structure that's large. Okay, so a large above-ground plant also has a large food storage organ underground, and it's only those larger plants that can do this, can produce a dense cluster of fruits. So if you're a small plant and you produce this inflorescence, you have to be a male. You produce a dense cluster of male flowers because the male flowers produce pollen, and then they're done with reproduction. And so the amount of resources needed to produce pollen is much less in jack-in-the-pulpit than the resources needed to produce this dense cluster of fleshy fruits here. So what the plant is doing is it's matching resource availability, the amount of resources in that bulb that's underground, with the gender of the inflorescence that's produced. So a female plant like this, which is a dense cluster of fruits like this, how big is that underground bulb after it's produced these fruits? It's very small. It's expended its resources on producing these fruits. So the next year, a plant that's female, when it comes up the next year, and this is its two leaves. It's probably won't even have any resources for the leaves to rest. And so that plant may go 2 or 3 or 4 years, depending on environmental conditions, as a vegetative plant. And then maybe it, as the bulb gets larger, progresses to being a male and produces clusters of male flowers within the pulpit. And then only later on, when the bulb has reached some minimum size, will it produce a cluster of female flowers and like this. This is an unusual strategy in plants, where an individual plant switches gender over its lifespan. But what I've tried to explain to you this evening is why a plant would exhibit this behavior, matching resources to the increased costs of being a female and producing those clusters of berries. Our third plant here that's unusual is pink lady slipper. And what a beautiful plant to encounter in the wild. I think it's one that can make our hike, and maybe you remember where you saw that plant, and maybe you want to go back to that again, see it next year. Planted flowers in early spring, and it has, it's called the lady slipper in the name because the flower almost looks like a slipper with, here's the top of the slipper where you might put your foot in here, and then this is the front of the slipper. So it's a kind of a large, it's a large pouch-like flower. It's quite striking, and it has these nectar guides, these pink lines, and they're even somewhat fragrant. So it's looking like there'd be a lot of reward for a potential pollinator, and bees are the insect that visits these flowers, bumblebees typically, and they somehow find their way into the opening here of the slipper, the flower, and they fly in here, maybe thinking that there's going to be a whole bunch of nectar here in this sac-like structure, but there's none to be found. The lady slipper orchids are nectarless, and the pollen is not readily available to them as a food source. It's a kind of a specialized packaging of pollen, and they can't really collect it, so there's nothing in the way of a food reward for the bees that visit these flowers. So this plant is employing deceit. It's trying to deceive potential pollinators, flower visitors, into visiting the flower, but it's not giving them any kind of reward. So bees are not dumb. They figure out that these flowers aren't offering a reward. They may visit 3 or 4 flowers before they give up, though. So occasionally, they do pollinate flowers. There have been some studies on this. And a typical lady slipper orchid that have been studied in North America, typically 5% or so, 5% or less, of the flowers successfully mature fruits. So the payoff is not high in the sense of numbers of flowers that successfully mature fruit. It's very low, but when a fruit does mature, because the seeds are so tiny, in orchid seeds, they're about the size of not much bigger than a grain of dust. They're really tiny. It's just really an embryo. It's just really a fertilized egg that's formed an embryo with a single layer of cells around it. There's no stored food for the embryo. But a single fruit like this may contain something like 5,000 seeds. Okay, so a number of seeds, and it seems to work for the lady slipper or orchid, although the bees obviously are not happy with this plant. And yellow lady slippers are the same. They're also utilizing deceit as a pollination mechanism. And you know, bees can fly into the flowers. They discover the hole here, but apparently it's much harder for them to fly out of the hole than it is to fly in. They have a hard time. And I've actually been around these flowers and I've heard a buzzing sound, and it almost seems like the bees are crashing into the, they're getting frustrated trying to get out. Claustrophobic. Bees can be claustrophobic. But here's a flower where apparently a bee has chewed its way out, gave up on finding the exit hole and chewed its way out. So let me end. If you kind of like this natural history stuff and would like to learn more about the ecology and natural history of Wildflowers and Plant Communities of the Southern Appalachian Mountains. It's unusual in having a lot of that ecology and natural history information. It's also unusual in that the plants are organized by their natural communities. So the plants are organized like how you see them in nature, not by flower color, not by taxonomic family, but by how you see them in nature, in their native habitat or community. And at the beginning of the book, I have these thumbnail photos of common and conspicuous plants of each of 20 different major communities in the Southern Appalachian Mountains in Piedmont. So if you're going to visit a cove forest, for example, if you're going to go to Station Cove Falls, or you're going to go to Pearson's Falls in Saluda, you can go to the thumbnail photos at the beginning of the book for cove forest, and you'll see coming attractions, plants that you're likely to see in that particular community type. And so the second part of the book describes the different communities, including how to identify each of the 20 communities. And then it tells you things about the community and has a list of common and conspicuous species of that community. And then the other book, Waterfalls and Wildflowers in the Southern Appalachians, 30 Great Hikes. These are interpretive hikes, so I've picked 30 hikes to waterfalls that have good to excellent seasonal wildflowers. So I picked hikes that lots of wildflowers, lots of diversity, and then I described the wildflowers and some other natural history features as well that you might encounter along the hike. And each hike also has a species list broken down seasonally. Spring flowering plants, the spring to summer, summer and fall flowering plants. And 21 of the 30 hikes are in the Carolinas. Most of them are in Western Carolina, in the mountains above you here. Many off the Blue Ridge Parkway, and in Great Smoky Mountain National Park and such. In any case, this is Graveyard Fields, right about, probably early May. And you know, the fall colors are so wonderful in the mountains, but how about these spring colors? It's pretty striking here. This is red maple in fruit, and this is serviceberry, amelanchier, in flower here. And it's really, really quite striking. So now's the time of year to get out, see the wildflowers, enjoy these pleasant temperatures, and have fun exploring the wildflowers. Thanks so much for coming out tonight.